Steve Lawson, The Narrow Way to Life. An audio blog commentary by The Ears to Hear. This short excerpt from Steve Lawson speaking on the topic of the narrow gate is a good example of how Lordship Salvation theologians violate numerous fundamental sovereign grace precepts when they interpret Scripture. Let me quickly review a few of those with you. First, repentance is commanded, and therefore an act of obedience. And any act of obedience is a work of righteousness. Matthew 3:2. Second, we are saved not by works of righteousness which we have done. Titus 3:5. Third, all of the requirements of eternal salvation were met by Christ, not by us. Hebrews 1:3, 2 Timothy 1:9. And finally, man in his natural state is incapable of receiving spiritual truth. 1 Corinthians 2:14, and unable to respond based on spiritual deadness, Ephesians 2:1. Let's listen to Lawson's statement and take a moment to explicitly point out how his assertions contradict the aforementioned sovereign grace precepts.
The fact that this is a narrow gate requires repentance.
It is evident from Lawson's statements that he is equating entry by the narrow gate to eternal salvation. This creates an enormous problem for any who would assert that man is totally depraved, as Lawson does. If total depravity is true, then the unregenerate man is incapable of entry because he is dead, Ephesians 2:1. In contrast, a regenerate man is capable of entry, but he is also already in possession of eternal life, and thus his entry by the narrow gate cannot be for the purpose of obtaining eternal life. Stated bluntly, if entry by the narrow gate is a requirement for eternal salvation, then one is denying depravity by asserting that an unregenerate man could perform such a task, and denying that Christ's one obedience made us righteous, because clearly under such a system, the obedience of one who entered at the narrow gate is also required.
It requires leaving your baggage behind. It requires leaving behind the love of sin and the love of the world and love of self.
Regeneration comes to those who are dead in trespasses and in sins, Ephesians 2:1. It requires no prerequisite effort on their part whatsoever, much less any leaving behind of baggage or love of the world and self. The abject depravity of man makes that an unalterable impossibility.
Jesus said, if any man shall come after me, he must deny himself and take up a cross and follow after me.
Well, the Lord said that, no doubt about it. But what is the Lord talking about? Is he suggesting that an unregenerate man must commit a righteous act of obedience in order to obtain the free gift of eternal life? If so, then he is most certainly preaching salvation by works. No, the Lord is talking about the cost and difficulty which attend the path of the regenerate disciple in this life, not the means whereby an unregenerate man may obtain the eternally saving grace of God.
There is no way to come through this narrow gate except you strip down and strip away all self-sufficiency and all self-righteousness, and you humble yourself and you come as a little child into the kingdom of heaven.
Again, if we're talking about eternal salvation here, then we are addressing the unregenerate. How might the unregenerate strip away all sufficiency and self-righteousness when the Bible's testimony regarding such men is that they are together become unprofitable, Romans 3:12, and when, through the pride of their countenance, they will not seek after God, Psalm 10:4. Won't the pride of their countenance prevent them from humbling themselves? This interpretation is so at odds with the sovereign grace precept of depravity as to make one wonder how so many of God's children who claim to affirm the doctrines of grace are deceived by this nonsense.
And it is a narrow gate whereby you can only come one at a time. You can't come in a group. You're going to have to peel off from the group. You're going to have to break from the pack. You're going to have to break even from your family and come one at a time to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is calling everyone under the sound of His invitation to leave where they are and to leave what they are and to come immediately to Him and to enter through the narrow gate.
The gospel is not an invitation. It is a proclamation. It is not offering a potential salvation contingent upon faith. It is proclaiming an actual salvation which is evidenced by faith. The notion that God is calling everyone under the sound of his invitation is categorically false, given the sovereign grace affirmation that Jesus did not purpose to save all of humanity, Ephesians 1, 4, and 5, neither did he covenant to save all of humanity, John 17, 2.
You need to know that the gospel is a command.
The gospel is not a command. It is a proclamation of the finished work of Christ, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4. This truthful proclamation is most certainly attended by certain logical ramifications, namely, that if you believe this testimony, you should respond by living in thankful and obedient discipleship under the precepts of the Lord Jesus Christ, John 14, 15. That, however, is not the gospel, but the unavoidable logical ramification of gospel truth.
And you will either live in obedience or disobedience to this Christ who is calling you to enter through the narrow gate.
Here, Lawson makes it plain that our salvation is in some measure dependent upon our obedience to his beloved gospel command. To suggest that our obedience plays any role in the work that brought God's people eternal salvation is a denial that God's people were made righteous by the obedience of one, Romans 5:19, as well as the insistence that such righteous standing is only made possible by the obedience of two. In short, it is just old-line decisionism, not the teaching of salvation by sovereign grace. Jesus Christ taught that, "He who is of God heareth God's words," John 8:47. In contrast, Lawson insists that one must hear and obey God's words, and only then will one be of God. That is yet another denial of depravity.
And to fail to respond to this gospel is to commit the greatest sin under heaven. It is to trample underfoot the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it is to insult the Spirit of grace, who would be convicting.
If grace is irresistible, then it is impossible to insult the Spirit of grace who would be convicting, at least in an eternally saving sense, as Lawson says. The simple fact of the matter is that the Spirit of grace does not convict everyone, and those it does convict are all saved because his grace is irresistible, and they would have absolutely no spiritual conviction whatsoever were it not for the spiritual capacity of faith that dwells in them as an evidence that they are already born again and thus already in possession of eternal life.
To say no to the gospel of Christ is to commit the greatest sin.
The gospel is a news account. It tells God's people of what the Lord Jesus Christ accomplished on their behalf. It is not offering eternal life to all of humanity. Indeed, Lawson's own affirmation of particular redemption makes this a matter of ironclad certainty. I believe that the Neo-Calvinistic Lordship Salvation doctrine of eternal salvation is more honestly represented by the following statements. God is offering eternal life to everyone in the gospel, though he did not send his Son to die for all of them. Man is depraved and salvation is monergistic. Nevertheless, one must strive to enter at the straight gate if they are to have eternal life. Stated very plainly, the doctrine of Neo-Calvinistic Lordship Salvation, as taught by Lawson, MacArthur, Washer, and a host of others, is an irrational theology that establishes the flock of God on confusion and contradictions rather than on the rock whose work is perfect. Deuteronomy 32:4. Perhaps more to the point is that Jesus said, "Thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him," John 17:2. This brings two questions to mind. First, will Jesus make good on this covenant promise? Yes. And second, do any of God's elect family stand in any danger of ending up in eternal damnation? No. No.